Greetings. In the name of the Most High, welcome to the Zeph Report. Zeph Daniel, your host. And we're on for another day. I still owe the intros and outros to this show so they can be tapped on to make it official. And I will do that because I think that it is important. It's just I'm knee-deep in a project. I don't know how many minutes it is, but I've been working on a couple of things. One from Kelly, that she submitted these pieces of our story in music form. And I so enjoyed the vibe of that. It was some eight minutes worth of stuff. And it's maybe can be cut up a little bit. But the story is about a guy that's been killed. He doesn't know he's really dead. And he thinks he's on Mars, which is another bizarre thing. He thinks he's underground on Mars, but then turns out not to be the case. And actually, it's ambiguous as to whether he's dead or not. He's not sure what the situation is, but his memory is being... nice and clumsy. His memory is being tapped to find out just if he knows what's going on, and everyone talking to him seems to be a reflection of himself. At the same time, he really is in an exotic situation. He's not quite sure what to make of how he instantly travels various places. For example, a disco on Mars filled with people. Now that begs the question, well, Zeph, why are we doing this? Just like, well, why do I do anything? Well, I just want to find out where the story goes. I'm not quite sure at this point. But one thing's for sure, you won't be disappointed. And indeed, it's work. Yeah, it's work, but it's good work. It's worthwhile. I think the world should have this, because I think basically what we're doing is we're asking all the wrong questions. I just went to a guy's site who was, all he does is pose possibilities. And so naturally he's fallen into the flat earth phenomenon and is really riffing with that. And the poor people who follow him, and you know, it's a very popular medium to sit there talking to a YouTube for 15 minutes or 20 minutes. You know, like if I did that, I could have the outside setting, beautiful setting against the New Mexico mountains, in various locations, and it really works. You get lots and lots of listens that way. I have opted for audio because I was called to audio. It's kind of like Dance with the One Who Brought Me, but because audio tends to use your mind. And the mind is more powerful than a fixed image that I show you. Now, I'm not against video. I probably will do these shorter videos when I get, if I can find some kind of time. I know for a fact that the Zeph Report's going to run out in terms of time. And it's really, I just have to hearken to the Lord on that. I mean, this form of it. I don't think the music will, but but I'm not really in music. I'm not sure what exactly I'm doing in the studio, but somehow my skills keep coming up. And I think you're going to hear that with Kelly's new piece, but it's, you know, it's cut into a bigger story and other music cues, etc., and sound effects. And so I'm getting into like a multi-layered including dialogue that I must do, because I'm playing the characters and I'm basically, in a way, talking to myself and thinking for a while that those are different people, then ultimately discovering the idea that it's been me talking to myself. And then, of course, eventually there's an angel introduced to help guide this poor fool on to the next thing. And, of course, he's... He thinks maybe that he got killed. He thinks maybe he did wrong. But then again, that's also shown as another random thought that's irrelevant. I mean, you're only here where you are now, right? However you got here is pretty much irrelevant. I mean, the fact that we're here, obviously you've done bad things. Obviously there's a karmic kind of reaping going on. Or you wouldn't be in this situation. You see where I'm going with it. So, you know, it's my own kind of collage version of radio theater, I suppose. But at the same time, it's just another quest. I'm finding no difference between fiction and what we might call reality. I'm not seeing any difference at all. I'm seeing the blurring of the lines. In fact, I could report on 923 and how everything points to 923. But I won't. Why not? Because it would be dishonest of me. I'd be trying to cash in. Now, hopefully later today on the Z and Frankie, we'll have the Z and Frankie, we'll be able to talk about this. Because once we're back past 923, 924, oh, I'm sorry, 928! That's the blood moon. But once we're by all that, by September 30th, what are we going to do about it? What are we going to think about it? Are the ones cashing in going to be held accountable? The answer, of course, is no. They will not be held accountable. Why not? Because the reward is for entertainment. And the fear porn is entertainment. No different than telling a story around the campfire. Or a big blockbuster movie predicting the end of the earth. The line between fiction and so-called reality, I'd say the agreed upon reality, is completely blurred. There is no difference. In Jesus' name, they put fiction out every day to be taken seriously as reality. So at this point, you see what I'm going to do with it. I'm going to just set it aside and say all of it is irrelevant. None of it is reality. All of it is fiction. Whatever we say is real is fiction. Whatever we say is fiction seems is real. So this flat earther, and it was someone I had known a long time ago, and I'm like, oh, you look like you've aged like me. And I knew there was something wrong with him, you know, I mean, obviously off, and he's been out there a long time talking, and he's found the way to go is to have a nice shot and for YouTube, and do 15, 20 minutes, which, by the way, is a lot less labor intensive than one of these. I'm just saying. With the YouTube, you don't have time for the inspiration to hit. You have to sort of be inspired, know what you're going to say, and then get on with it. And if it goes much beyond 15, 20 minutes, I find that the audience loses interest. That's another interesting thing. But if it goes about 15 minutes, and you're just really depicting life, your struggle with the mechanic. Here you are eating at a restaurant. You know, you shield the faces of people and you kind of show certain shots. I find that the public is very hungry for that kind of cinema verite. In other words, what they want is something real, someone's life, and being brought in on it. You know, the struggles, the ups and downs, the sorrow and heartbreak, the elation, having fun, having trepidation, the car, anything's good for a story. The car breaks down. The bill collector comes to take your car. make another good video. I saw one guy, he was just down the street. There were homeless people, and he went and said, "Hey, can I help you out?" And then he walked away from them. And but then he was smart not to have the camera showing the faces. TGIF with friends, Brewski's mindless football entertainment on the television, and just a few snippets of people talking. And whatnot. And really what's going on there is there's a need for people to tune into something that seems to have a semblance of the reality that they remember that is no longer here. That, oh, look, I can look at this. And you see, it's the same thing. It's a grounding experience. I mean, here's someone struggling with whatever they're doing. And they're going through their life, and they're sharing, you know, their cereal, their, you know, they're getting ready to go see a movie, and then what they think about it afterwards. I mean, anything is fair game. It's because people need somehow something like that to tune into, and then of course it attracts trolls who love to just simply throw mud and insults at it all. And then people that are loyal listeners, and they get involved with your life. But it's really not your life, it's what you choose to show them. It's really a fiction. And in some cases, people actually get money thrown at them through PayPal and whatnot, as a donation for the show to keep going. And it's fair game, you know, passing the hat for something like that, for them letting you into their lives. Probably fair exchange, right? But why do you do it? I'm not asking whether one should do it. I'm simply asking why does that fascinate us? It's because, friends, we're hopelessly messed up. We're lost. Don't you see that? We've been killed. We died. And we're adrift, trying to look for anything that reminds us of what it used to be like. Now, all this has happened in the spiritual realm. We're only aware of it going in slow motion here on the earth. It's another dichotomy between what's really going on, which we have been barred from, and what's not going on, but is a semblance of what's going on in slow motion in a 3D situation like this. I always told you that the reptiles are very slow, didn't I? They're very slow to move, to react. They don't quite get it when it's going on. They certainly have no spiritual discernment whatsoever. Not like you. That's why they're after you. And, you know, and that harkens to the serpent, you know, the fallen angels, whatever, you know, but they're after you because you've got something they can't do. They're very slow moving. So this 3D existence that they've propped up, this sort of simulated world we're in, is something they understand. It's something I do not understand. And so when I see these bits and pieces of memories, and when I think about Mars and, you know, other planets, space, and I think about what was lost, and I think about being here back in kindergarten, remedial learning, because I guess we just didn't quite get it the first time around, or the second, or wherever we were, we didn't quite get it. So in looking at memories of ourselves, i.e. sharing on the internet, on YouTube, in a way what we're trying to do is we're trying to remember who we really are. And I have to say all this because, you know, this person on the internet was saying that, you know, he doesn't believe in anything absolute. He doesn't have any, he doesn't believe anything absolute. I mean, I think that sums it up. He used to be looking for something in the churches, but he asked too many questions, he said, so they wanted him gone. So I kind of feel a kindred spirit to that. But the conclusion he came to have no conclusion, that everything is relative, whatever you think is fine, regarding anything, is in a way the reason that he's here. So it's not surprising he's fallen into being an advocate for the flat earth dialogue. Of course, people like that will fall into those dialogues. And he believes, he's pretty sure, that when people find out that we've been lied to about everything, including all the planets out there, and all the universe, and all the different galaxies, and all the different billions and trillions of whatever, that all of it is just basically we're in a simulated world here, a kind of a terrarium, if you will, you know, for whatever reason, and by whoever built it, and why the heck we're here. You see, the only way out of that situation, well, to me, that's intolerable. That just means, okay, we're in prison, and there is no way out. Is that okay with you? You're screwed. We might as well call it hell, you know, capital H, and say, okay, that's it. No sense thinking anymore. No sense trying to go anywhere. No sense trying to find something absolute. Which, by the way, without absolute and absolute, without an axis, without a foundation, we have no life. We just drift with endless questions. And I suppose if you want to make YouTubes of endless unanswered questions, go ahead. But don't think for a minute you're helping anyone. You're just, you know, an enabler for people who are stuck with the same relativity and the same rather relative questions that go nowhere about anything and everything. And where the fad is now is that nothing is real. I was thinking of the song Strawberry Fields Forever, the Beatles, and Nothing to Get Hung About, Nothing to Get Upset About. They just kind of give in and float downstream, right? Enjoy yourselves, you're young. There's no sense, nothing to see here, strawberry fields forever. Nothing to really worry about, nothing to think about, no fire lit under anything or anyone, no absolutes, everything relative. Just float downstream. And that was very popular back in the late 60s, and it's back again now today, so I find that very interesting. Along with the revolutionaries who back then they would burn down the schools, and now they're in government. And you're sitting there, they're getting ready to kill you, and you're just like, what? I mean, you know, well, what when you have a certain kind of tree, what kind of fruit it produces, don't you? So I don't want to hear any more complaining. You know, this is what we wanted, and this is what we have. You know, if we want something else, we'll have it. But, you know, it seems that the fictional fear porn and all the Jesus purveyor, I mean, there's every reason in the world not to follow Jesus Christ. Number one reason, the people who follow Jesus Christ. That's numero uno. And I think that might have happened to this poor bloke. He was on his little show and, you know, doing his 15-minute thing. And he was talking about how he was doing an introduction after he's been there for the longest time with his thing about aliens and star gods and what, you know, whatever, the Anunnaki, or I don't know, you know, that whole sort of quasi-Art Bell kind of pursuit. And the problem these guys get into is like he finally comes to a conclusion, there is no conclusion. And we just ask questions. And born-again Christians are evil and stupid. And you know what I mean? There was that kind of thing that I saw. And I just thought, ah, okay, so he's burned by the church and he couldn't find answers there. He threw it all out the window, meaning he was never called, he was never chosen, he was never... So I said, okay, Lord, let's think about someone that has not been called. And they said, well, Zeph, you were just putting down this whole thing as a simulated reality. And no. I honor it in the sense that, you know, I know the Lord is the only way. I'm just saying the perception out there. But for whatever reason, this is what's created. And you know, we are, you know, we can either sit here and say it's a big question mark and spin around selfishly, doing selfish things, or we can find a way out. And when I say selfish and not selfish, that doesn't mean helping the old lady across the street or helping someone like me, the old man across the street. That's not what I'm talking about. I mean selfish, self-oriented consciousness versus outward or Godward-oriented consciousness. You see, I found that the Godward-oriented consciousness bears fruit. And it's not necessarily, you know, I mean, this person also is also a shill. And I have to say this. It may sound harsh, but it's not. There's no invective here. I'm just simply saying a shill because of the fact that they're set up anti, you know, to unravel all your reality and then give you nothing in return. And there's a few willing people that just keep thinking he's brilliant and he's wonderful. And I'm just watching this little cult leader, you know, and I'm looking at this and I'm saying, well, so what would be the motivation of these people? It's because he gives you something, you know, in other words, yes, you're right. It's, we can't figure it out. I can relate to that. So I tune in because it's another thing that I can identify with. And in so doing, I feel a degree of comfort. And because I feel a degree of comfort, I keep tuning in, even though we're going nowhere. We're going in circles. And this is what's wrong with people. What? I was, you wonder why I do? Well, I do what I do is show prep. It's all for this podcast here, but this podcast ends, Trish. I believe it will be on my 13th year anniversary, so that's less than a year away. So I feel a need to say everything that needs to be said. So I can go to the same place of unraveling everything, But what I have at the end of the day, and of course, he was using the euphemism of born-again Christian, not the actual teaching of Jesus, which is so vital and important. The whole idea of a born-again Christian came from the discussion Jesus is having with Nicodemus, trying to explain to him the difference between, you know, the world and faith, between the spirit and the flesh. You have to be born of the spirit, in other words. You know, God causes us to be born of the spirit, and so we're on the spiritual quest. But it's more like something that's in our blood. We can't get away. It's not like you can leave it. It's something that happens to you, i.e. born again. You're born of the world, 3D, the flesh, whatever. But now there's this other dimension that you're born into. And yes, it has structure and it has an absolute. And I think people refuse to be, say, born again because they don't want an absolute. You know, they're very Luciferian in the sense that they want to rebel. Okay, fine. Nobody really, you know, so this guy, he doesn't want any absolute thing there. He's just on his own thinking about things. And if we all get together and think about things, we'll find the answer. No, we won't. That's a lock and a guarantee. So I watched this person, and I'm not going to, you know, say anything more about it. I don't want to be, you know, terribly disrespectful. You know, just disrespecting the concept of having thrown out the Lord, thrown out, you know, because of corruption. I mean, for obvious reasons, and especially judgmentalness and the rest of it. And then, instead of doing anything about it, instead of the really hard razor's edge quest for God, which is the only answer you're ever going to get, just throw it all out and say, I'm the center of the universe, and what I think is you know, that's fine. And settle. Well, folks, I can't settle like that. I had a lot of professors in school like that. You know, they weren't quite sure what reality was, but we can sit here spinning the different questions around, and then that's the fun of it, spinning them around and getting nowhere. Meanwhile, our society's gone off the cliff and going down the tubes, our world, into a totalitarian regime of pure hell on earth that you can't even imagine. And it's because in any society, one must have an absolute. There must be God and, say, godly principles enforced. I'm sorry, it's not about judgmentalism, and I'm about to say something that's going to make me a real hater. But the reason our society is failing is because Satanists have gotten a hold of it, and what they want to do is make new laws to go against anything Judeo-Christian, i.e. no paradigm, no absolute. It's everything is relative, and then it devolves automatically to totalitarianism. Now, what about that statement don't you understand? What about that don't you get? There is no, I understand we've been wargaming the fight with Russia, and the Pentagon's determined that we would win. No, Pentagon, you will never win another war. Win is not a concept that you even factor in. Outcomes, isn't that your job? Outcomes. You know, scenarios. You have lost your way. If you want the United States of America to be great again, as Donald Trump does, and the military to be great, there's only one way. Whether you like it or not, what I hate is when people disagree with God, something they know nothing about. Then they spin around in the relative terms in their own little 3D minds, trying to figure it all out, and they wind up with nothing but questions and no answers. Meanwhile, we all go off the cliff. Yes, I have an objection to that, sir. Thank you. And if you don't like it, make a rebuttal. But I'm pretty sure any rebuttal to this podcast would be something like, more questions. It's so, he was putting down anyone who came to an absolute, who thought they knew absolutely what the truth was. Anyone who thinks they know absolutely what the truth is, or they have something absolute, is basically evil. The alternative, of course, is, you know, death, because it's devolves to a totalitarian regime where mass death is the order of the day. And of course, maximum suffering of people. Because man has decided to go with his own mind and his own feelings of how he thinks what would be a fair society. He's incapable of ruling himself, folks. And has shown that throughout the ages. So where our laws were based on morality, things this man finds repugnant, on something absolute, it caused probably the greatest artistic and innovative civilization of all time to burgeon. Yes, it's always been good versus evil. There's always been corrupt versus incorrupt. There's always been that conflict now. There's always been that conflict. You could always make a case, oh, they're all evil, I'm going to go to another planet. You know, I do that all the time. Or under the sea or whatever, you know. You'd think that you would relate to that, but I find very few people can relate to my, to where I'm at. And I think it's just because because I cannot imagine doing a mundane podcast about mundane things just to hook you in, just to have a show. Can you imagine? Well, I just can't do it. I would feel very dishonest if I did that. But yes, I too have tuned into those things. And I must force myself not to. Because you see, it's only a fiction. Fiction is like more questions. We're not getting an answer. We need an answer. We can't live without an answer, my friends. We must have something absolute to go from, or we are lost. Lost and killing each other. These people have made a case against anything absolute because if they look at the judgmentalism, the church, the Inquisition, the wars, the crusades, intolerance, the burning of witches who may not have been witches, and the rest of it. All from that kind of implacability, from that absolutism. So we're just very gentle here, asking questions, not harming anyone or a tree or a blade of grass, just having questions about something we know nothing of. And we have no intention of finding any answers, because if we do, we would get absolute about it. And we don't want to do that because it's very un-PC. So we're just going to keep on going the way we're going in our little relative slumber that signifies nothing. And it's okay, because we can get lots of people tuning in to our 15 minutes of fame every day. I'm sorry. But that pissed me off. Well, those of you who are out there, and you probably figure out that, you know, I'm talking about any number of people, but, you know, there's just a video I saw yesterday that pissed me off. Because I was told that, you know, born-agains are so, you know, like, caveman-ish, they're so backwards. And I'm like, oh my God, this man is seriously lost. In a sea of relativity, and he's got his little sycophantic followers humming the tune of nothingness and how great it is to ask questions with no answers, because lest we become didactic ourselves and repeat the same mistakes as all those other backwards people that led us to this point, you see. Now, someone ought to make a... We should enshrine this podcast on a capsule, you know, out in space for someone to hear it. This one. Because this one is almost anthropological. No, I'm not saying it as a, believe me, I'm well beyond the boasting stage. When you get older, that goes out the window. But if it is something, and this probably is a subject that is vital to the debate today, I will say it during the real-time presentation of it, not as a boast, but as a marker so you can understand, so, you know, and to see what you think about it, really. Well, at the same time, this would appeal to a very small percentage of the population, those who I suppose would be people with intellectual pursuits, but they get so angry, folks. You know, your philosophers, your intellectuals and so forth. They get so angry when someone who claims to be born again attempts in any way, shape, or form to enter the dialogue or the dialectic of asking questions philosophical in nature about our reality. They object to that very, very much because people like you ruin the party. Well, I'm the only one in the entire world who would have a communion and then talk about cutting his dick off. I mean, that's something that I should have on Z and Frankie. Well, no, I mean, I want to clarify that, by the way. well, you see, there was a thing I went through, and I instead of actually, you know, lopping it off, and there are people that have done that in terms of self-mutilators who have nullified that aspect of themselves. They call themselves nullos, oddly enough. And I've seen some with buff workout bodies, but with nothing down there, you know what I mean? And it was a curious thing. I understand that on some level, you know? I mean, I must have pivoted into this thing, but anyway. I tended to go to drugs instead. I didn't want to be bothered with sex because it brought up abuse issues and shame issues and painful issues for me. So that was tied to the sex drive. And so, you see, I wanted to get rid of that pain, so that was why I said what I said. I didn't have the best orientation to it in the world. And, you know, so it never became, you know, it's just... And that versus the satanic kids who went through the other side that were so loose and casual, throwing it around like, you know, they were so confident. And it made me feel even worse. So I was just fit to be. I just had a horrible experience with all that. And it seemed that everybody in those days wanted everybody to be, jumping into the orgy. You know what I mean? And if you had a problem in that area, you were just, you know, you're lucky if you even survived. It was all I'm very embarrassed by my peers because their entire lives were with their libido. It's almost like Kurt Cobain smells like Teen Spirit, you know, like the Nirvana, you know, which is all about that. It's all about what we're talking about. It's like, it's all about the libido, and it's all about social pressure to force everybody into their little game, which is very slow and reactive in nature. In other words, it's basically a covering that covers the evil of our entire society. But it all starts with the sex with kids. And then the clubs, and then the guilds, and then the secret societies, and then, you know what I'm saying? And it all revolves around that, right? And they become reptilian in consciousness, which is very slow moving. So they think about ruling the world rather than what is this? We have to figure a solution. They don't do that. They want to rule. They want to have a fool's paradise to rule over or something. I have no idea. The kingdom of stupidity, the kingdom of slow thinking, and you know, then there are the other ones who do a lot of meditation and all that. But it all comes back to the physical fashion show, which all goes back to the orgy, which all goes back to Satan, which all goes back to, and the, I'm sorry, but the serpent is not my ruler. It is their ruler. It is society's ruler, but not mine. And so long as that's the case, people don't, you know, and these guys that ask these questions, like, oh, it could be this, it could be that, and they go into the flat earth thing and the rest of it. You know, the problem is they don't even know there's organized Satanism. It's organized, right? It's all revolving around the children, sex, and the mind, right? Control of the mind through control of the sex and being orchestrated by a hierarchy of people and otherworldly type entities that keep an ironclad police state lockdown on the entire thing. And I'm sorry, but succeeding here in your, you know, rock music, pop music, this thing, that thing, your entertainment or whatever, entertainment is really what it is no badge of honor, believe you me. And once you see that, you stop striving for it. Because it is no badge of honor to be, to have accolades here, to win the President's Award for, you know, for whatever, for when Paul McCartney wins the award for whatever, his, for the arts or whatever it is from Obama. It's no honor, believe me. It's nothing to be proud about, believe me. It means that you've decided this is it, and this is, and it's just this game you're into, and it's this unto death. You've decided to keep your mouth shut, keep your mind turned off, and that's what it means. That's what it actually signifies. That I've gone with this reality, and I've won, and I hit the marker, and I'm a success, and boy, this is it. Life is sweet. And the answer to that is, no, it's not sweet. At best, it's bittersweet. At worst, it's just bitter. And it's unsatisfactory for most people. And so we're in a mass denial trying to make it satisfactory, but it never will be. The only way there's comfort then in this whole entire mess is you have to have something absolute. No, I don't invent God, because you see, I can't believe in God. He had to actually believe in me to show me that he exists, something absolute. I cannot quest for that answer and find it. No, it's not available. But at his timing, he can, if he chooses me, to show me something that he's absolutely. He showed me last night. He said, you know, you understand your society cannot stand with no absolute God. If with man's feelings and relative positions on things guiding the way, you will sink into totalitarianism and mass death. I said, I know that, Lord. I started thinking about the laws that have been passed, and I realized that it's all about a prelude to totalitarianism and mass death. I realized that everything that's being passed is a pathway to mass death and genocide, or rather, totalitarianism and genocide. I see now that the whole goal of changing the laws is for the idea of a great tribulation of mass death. I see that none of these laws are for fairness or the rights of women to choose or fighting against the war on women or the war on blacks or the war on this or the war on that. That all of it is a pursuit to become relative, i.e. throw out God's laws, do everything the opposite, so that it leads to the end game and end result, which is a permission and ability to harm man muchly under the color of law, to enslave, to harm, and to kill at will, to teach human that they are nothing, and that they're to be subjected. If they don't want to be harmed, they will obey, they will enslave themselves, and they will be obedient in order to be allowed to exist on this planet. And to finally reveal to people that's the position they're in, and proclaim victory over them. that every law that's being changed, every judge like Judge Roberts, the Congress, they're all complicit in wanting this new world order. But the new world order is nothing new. It's basically enslavement and mass death of innocent people for the purpose of extracting power to do something else, to try to extend their lives and their pleasures and their fields of dreams and their hopes and wishes for the future based on the blood of innocents running freely. I realize that everything that's going on in our society is about that. It's not about gay rights. It's not about racism. It's not about any of the progressive causes. It's not about any of those things. It's all about enslavement, totalitarianism, and mass death. It has nothing else to do with anything else. You get to this point when you throw God out, and man becomes relative to his own thinking, what feels good, what feels right, what feels fair, meeting that out in his own mind. And then, of course, it devolves into complete, total tyranny. Now, what would have to be done to get off this track to complete destruction? I think most people realize we're on a path to destruction, don't you? What would have to happen to get us off that path to destruction? Okay, well, you'd have to have laws based on God. So you see, that's not going to happen again. Got rid of God and proclaimed victory with the Baphomet statue in Detroit. Didn't you see that? Didn't you see how it was focused on little kids? Didn't you see that was a war cry for pedophilia? Don't you get it? I mean, you know, if any decent person would make sure that thing doesn't exist, if you know what I mean. I guess there's no decent people in Detroit anymore. Or they're all cowed. But I mean, well, you can go to court about it too. If that's the kind of thing that's going to start popping up around here, I give this society about 2 seconds before it devolves into total hell. Meaning pain and suffering for the masses, but to be blamed on those people that are preventing progress. Therefore pitting one group against another in a total hellish fish in a barrel shoot. Do you like that? So when I see these people on the internet throwing God out and putting down born-again Christians, you see, and barring us from the table of philosophers, I am so outraged, and it's good that I don't have to be, that I'm physically removed from this person. Because you see, that kind of pursuit is what leads to the tyranny that everyone complains about that will surely engulf us. That is, nothing real, everything relative, everything a question, and no answer. I was horrified. I listened to 15 minutes of it, and it just went in circles and said nothing. And people cheered on how brilliant this man was. I had to walk away in horror, obviously. And I said, Lord, what went wrong here? I mean, and it's like, you know, there's no connection there that never was. Because this man decided that God was out. It's too didactic and too judgmental, and it's all based on man's projections anyway. To enact laws that he wants to enact, it's another corruption. How's it different from doing what you feel is fair and right and honorable and just? Right? I'm just saying that the laws and edicts of man must come from the absolute source of God, or we will devolve into tyranny and mass death misery, and continue lost adrift within anything as anything attitude that yields nothing ever. No reverence for the Lord equals destruction. Further to that, I was thinking, what would I do to fix the society? Well, first of all, I would not tolerate. See, there's the word, tolerance. I would not, I absolutely would, we cannot tolerate Satanists. I'm going to get right down to it. They, you know, just like the progressives and people like this have said that my kind needs to die. I'm sorry. I would call this guy, I guess, a soft Luciferian, perhaps, or an unwitting one, not realizing what side he's on. The bottom line here is, because everyone's on a side, you're all on a side. You know, every last one of you on earth is on a side. You're just in denial. You're just nuts if you think that's not the case. So there's certain things that are absolute. One thing is the society that allows the satanic to take over, that becomes a world of tyranny, mass death, you know, genocide, misery and suffering, enslavement for all. That's what happens every time it's tried. Most of these people are in secret societies and worship Satan. So what are you going to do about it? And their laws are all going the way that I predicted they would go, perfectly in lockstep. And we'll eventually come to that result because God is not mocked. What you sow, so shall you reap. Period. Now, yes, is that absolute? Yes, it's pretty absolute. What I just said will happen exactly. And is already happening exactly. You know, the things like that kind of corruption is encouraged. Like when you get away with lying to Congress, you're cheered now. The whole founding of America is wrong, so throw it all out, including God, and just establish man as the dictator. Then you're in for some misery, folks. That's why they all want to outlaw religion, because they didn't want God. If you were listening to God and not the dictator, they wanted you dead. And that's the way they are today in the United States. You know, so to fix it, you'd have to, there'd have to be a policy of intolerance towards Satanists, which would be, since they're undetectable, because it all stays concealed, you'd have to detect it. It would just seem like a Joe McCarthy thing, you know. It almost might seem unfair. But you could round them all up and put them on an island somewhere, I suppose. And I guarantee if you put them all on an island together, they will just do each other in. They'll go back 2 years later, there'll be no one left. Because that's the way it is with them. These are, you know, criminals. And, you know, if you leave them go, here's what they will do. They will make legal all of their, you know, anti-God proclivities. For example, pedophilia. Good example, right? For example, a ritual sacrifice, human sacrifice. Well, that's already, you know, it's in plain sight, but it's not completely legal in the ritualistic sense. You know, there'll be anyone who disagrees with them, of course, put to death. I mean, that'd be another kind of thing. You know what I mean? You know, what is Jade Helm? You know, the communist government is a manifestation of Satanism, and that's a perfect representation of the satanic. If you read the Communist Manifesto, it's basically satanic all the way down. Immorality, corruption, criminality, all to be enshrined as legal. Yes, there are things, you know, and agreed. You know, they're never going to go back to that. They call themselves progressives now. They're progressing in their laws against, in their edicts against God. That's exactly right. And they're putting the, you know, the born-again Christian in the crosshairs. And once we get rid of that, then we really win. But ultimately, the whole world would then devolve into chaos and mass death, because basically the game Satan's playing is, well, it's really about mass death. You know, these people get to live another 2 seconds longer, but they're all going to die too. Ha ha. So that's the real game. But they're too stupid to figure that out. And they don't learn from history because they're like lizards. They're very slow in learning, slow in consciousness. Obama's very slow. He keeps repeating the same, you know, the same memes over and over because he's slow. He's not innovative. He doesn't have original thinking. Everything is reactionary. Indeed, that's the lizard mind. And, you know, I sit here knowing the truth about all of it, and it's just, it's really, you know, and then when something happens, it's like, yep. Something else happens, yep. Something else happens, yep. But my friend with Mr. Relativity is like, well, we need to think about this, and maybe it doesn't happen that way. And it's like, it happens every time the same way. I think we can establish a cause and effect here. I think we can extract laws about all this. Yeah, but I mean, you're going to burn witches at the stake and kill gay people and all that? Yeah. No, you see, there's the rub. To me, I want to go to the root of the problem, and that is it's the basic structural Satanist run by the Jesuit world system. But then again, if you want to have a law against that, you have to have a law against the entire world system. That's not going to happen. So it's going to be impossible. I mean, I remember back in the past where they set up the FBI to go after communists, and basically that's Satanists. So to go after those people in the form of communists with Joe McCarthy and all that, that's what I'm talking about. You would have to instill that sort of thing. Because the communists, which are really Satanists, but we'll call them communists for now, that's fine. We can kind of line up with Brother Thomas's thing. If you don't get rid of them, this is what they do. And they'll do it with the gay thing. They'll do it with the kid thing. That's next, by the way. The abortion thing, that's all these are prong issues for them to get what they want, which is the enslavement of mankind. And that's they're obsessed with that, which is to trap them here so they don't get away. So the last thing they do is go with God. They have to outlaw God, because if they go with God, then we are screwed. We lose their souls. And we lose what gives us power. And that's what's going on the earth. I can say that absolutely. No need to start asking questions with no answers. I just gave you your answer. And so now the question becomes, well, what do we do, Lord? You see, and therein lies the path. That's the right way to that is the right way to think about things. To ask God's help. That's right. Why, oh, why does man think that he's qualified to prop himself up as dictator? I don't know. But, you know, eventually he will eat his own guts and be crying for more until he's finally put out of his misery. And I'm sorry to put it that way, but that's just the way it is without God. It all seems nice and touchy-feely now, and, you know, it's all about, you know, pleasure and sex and this and that. And ultimately it's not, though. It's a hard-nosed, you know, slavery that you're being wooed into through the pleasures of decadence. I don't know how to put it any more clear. I'm not perfect, man. I've contributed to the degradation of us all as well. But at least I know what the hell's going on. And this guy I saw on the tube, he seems to have just given up. I mean, not seems. He has given up. I'm sorry. He has given up. But you see, the reason I mention him is because he's like so many others out there that have given up. Oh, you know, I'm really spiritual. I'm not religious. Well, I was no religionista myself. But I'm not just, I'm okay, you're okay, spiritual. That's not me. I believe in the absolute truth. Absolutely believe. And if I don't try to align with that, I'm lost. And the only, you know, my success in this world is I've done, well, is my being here, but my healing from, you know, from traumas that didn't seem like I was going to be able to. Well, there was nothing wrong with me. See, here's the other thing that we didn't understand. There was nothing wrong with me. It's just that I was, you know, cut out a different way. No, a specific way, like billions of others and hundreds of millions and possibly billions of others cut out for the Lord. You know, wheat and tares. That's all. But when you're in a society like the one I was in, very decadent and you know, the elite society, that doesn't fit there. So that's all. That's all. But it was, you know, there was a lot of damage from it all. And like I say, I only knew one guy that actually survived out of many, many, many others. So it was a kind of a serious thing, you know, life and death and all that. And it continues to today, you know, where I'd be warned not to go to a restaurant and eat something because they're waiting for you. Yeah. They're waiting for you. Well, you know why they have the advantage, you know, in this country, Satan owns the United States. So they could kill you, you know, in a bar, let's say. And, you know, a phone call later, it's all cleaned up. No one knows what happened. Missing person report filed. Period. That's the end of it. That's just the way it rolls. You do a human sacrifice in plain sight in a public place, and it's just like, shh, never happened. Just a missing persons report. So they get a bizarre confidence they could just kill people and it'll be taken care of. So you have those out there, sicker than sick, who simply hunt the lambs of God. That's where you get your gang stalking and all that, because they're allowed to go that far. They can try to ruin someone's life and make them commit suicide. If they commit suicide, then they take credit. And by the way, for those of you who don't know what's going on, and it's all about questions, when someone does someone in like that, they get a boost, and you can see it in their bank statement. Oh, it may not last too long. I know a guy that got a pop. He got like 3 movies to act in. Ultimately, what ended up happening is he didn't do enough bad things, so he got, you know, left down there as in Relativeville. You know, he's kind of unemployed now. It gets hardcore. It's not, you know, it's not, they would say, well, it's not who you know, it's who you, you know, that statement. It's like, no, that's not right. It's not who you thrill, it's who you kill. You see, and that's the divide. That's where they, oh no, there's no murder charges. Oh, of course not. Not when it's done under the umbrella of that other world that coexists with this one, of course. And you see, that's the deep, dark, dirty secret, isn't it? If that's allowed to, because that's what runs our government, that's what runs the world, right? Because it's you go along because you don't want to be killed. Isn't that it? Isn't that the danger? Isn't that why people vote? Isn't that why Judge Roberts votes the way he votes? Because it's not really about blackmail. Blackmail is a small part of it. The guy's scared that he or his children will be killed, so he votes, he tortures himself to make Obamacare work, I mean, no matter what he has to do. Because otherwise, the price is death, or being discredited, or his life ruined. Multiply that by everybody. Now, that's absolutely what's going on here on the ground. And I guess my background, you know, helps me to help you see it for what it is, because it ran that way back then. Look at the Kennedy assassination. That's a perfect example of what I'm talking about. And once you understand all that, you have 2 choices. One, you can say, well, I'm just going to keep my mouth shut and try to do my best. Yeah, then please ask yourself the question, how come everybody else is doing so much better than me, and I don't seem to advance? The answer to that question is, buddy, you're a prodigal son or daughter. You're on the wrong side. You know, come home to the Lord and start tilling those fields. And you'll see things will turn around. You're just disoriented. You're on the wrong side. Oh, you didn't. Somehow you got born in the United States, the most materialistic country in the face of the earth that's ever been on the earth. Here, anything spiritual is illegal. I mean, you know, not wink illegal, but it's illegal. The reason they infiltrated all the churches and ruined them all is because they don't want people that have prophecy, prayer, spiritual warfare, discernment. They don't want people like that walking around out there because that poses a threat to their evil, nefarious plans of total domination and destruction of humankind. This is a very serious question. The question you and I are faced with is, do we survive as a species or not? I mean, that's ultimately where it all goes. Don't let anybody fool you. This is where all the philosophy questions go. If they don't go to survival of humanity, then they are lying to you and trying to get you into a relative conversation where nothing ever is resolved. Yes, it is resolved. You answer this question. Should humanity survive or not? If not, then just keep stroking yourselves. You know, keep surviving the way you've been, because you will see that day. If so, it should survive. Then there's only one answer. You must repent. You must go with the Lord and not the world. There is no other way to look at it, because there is no other paradigm that's been given to us. Why these charlatans want to obfuscate and hide the truth about what we're facing, I don't know why. It's because they work for the other side in a soft way. Obviously, they don't want to be, you know, if they're afraid of the truth, because if they ever found it, they would be, they feel, persecuted. So they make sure they never find it, and they confuse you in the process. Enter in YouTube. What are disinfo agents? Look, it's really quite simple. If we want America to survive, we must revere God as a people. If we don't, and if our laws don't reflect that reverence, then we will cease. Oh, you could move in all kinds of new, you know, the 2004 thing I uttered, which was that Americans would be replaced by foreigners. That's what I said. Turned out I was spot on. That very thing is what is happening now. So there's another one I can at least put a check mark next to and say, well, at least that wasn't like, you know, it wasn't a false prophecy there. It turned out to be exactly the policy. And I just sort of, you know, I don't know where this stuff comes from, but I can tell you one thing. That was like a vision, like a dream I had, you know, but it's come due. Well, whether they get their plan or not, I mean, you've been alerted to it so that you could do something about it. So we're hoping it doesn't become totally fulfilled. It's half fulfilled now, though, but hope you right. In other words, get the birth rates down, get everybody replaced, right over a long-term solution. No need for nukes or anything. We just replace the people with the people we want here and get rid of the people we don't want, you know, the Americans, right? Move them out, move the new people in, called New World Order. That is exactly what the plan is. That is exactly what they're doing. Is anyone doing anything about it? Not at all. No one's doing anything about it. The ethos out there is, look, America and you awful European white people, you've had your time. Now move off the stage. It's our time now. It's like, oh, great. They want to repeat the same thing over again that led us to this point. What a lovely world, Lord. This is just wonderful. How smart are they? Boy, they're geniuses, aren't they? The problem is things will devolve to chaos before they get their shot, which is fine. Which is fine. Good for man to see his own failure. Hopefully there's a few witnesses around after mass death that will say, gosh, maybe we screwed up. Maybe, I hope there's a few of you around that will at least be able to say to the Lord, hey, I think we screwed up. I mean, I hope to God there's a few of you around who might get out of your mental illness fog and admit by a little bit of self-examination, you know, Lord, maybe we did wrong and I'm sorry. Boy, I hated to destroy my children. and grandchildren and any hope of any future. Gee, I guess I screwed up, Lord. Well, I'm sorry I didn't consult with you. I thought I knew it all. Do you think we will ever hear anything so beautiful as that, ever? In today's world, no, you won't, because Satan is the very, definition of pride. And pride is how this entire show runs. Look at the Obama administration, look at everybody. It's all pride. It's all ego. The only reason that we're not destroyed on a global scale is because God's intervention and his angels intervening with, you know, with nukes, with all kinds of stuff, you know. Not total intervention, but intervention. You know, God will have his way with this earth. Those who don't tune into God will just, they're just going to be stuck not knowing what's going on. If you do tune into God, it means, you know, your life has to change, because you can't just, yeah, me and God, it's you submit, right? Now, I've also said, however you come to God, you're going to get to the same place I'm at with him. You know what I mean? Whatever religion, whatever cultural background, I don't care. You know, you pursue God, you're going to wind up in the same place. Eventually. People are at different levels of understanding. Understood. And I factor that in. But the thing not to do is throw God out and then go with, you know, your own relative thinking. Because at that point, you're screwed. And what is it makes us do that? That's called rebellion. Usually it's pride, right? So I'm sorry, you know. I'm going to back all this down. It just always gets to be so heavy around here, you know, with these talks. And then I feel like, you know, I guess what's happening is I'm trying to get them done, you know, and I have a huge project I'm doing that is, and I seem to be escaping the project and doing this in a way. And I'm trying to have the energy to do everything. And my energy has come up. Thank you very much. We went through some terrible, and now I want to pivot, switch, you know, get off this. Yes, I feel your frustration. The point is, you know, there's nothing I can, right, do about it but pray and talk to people on the internet here that they need to turn back to God. That's all I'm saying. I don't care what your proclivities are, whatever your thing is. It's just turn back to God and let God straighten it out, because I don't know the solution. I mean, round up the Satanists, I guess you'd have to round up half the world. Obviously, that's not going to happen. So I don't know the solution. I just say turn back to God. And admit, well, you have to examine yourself and come up with your shortcomings and say, Lord, I'm guilty. I'm sorry. I thought I was doing the right thing, but I wasn't. You know, it's okay. The mistake is when we all think we're so right and then we go off the cliff. And I think this guy is confusing this with God and feeling like you have to be right. It's like, no, I mean, in feeling like we're thinking right. Yeah, I got the right thing. I'm not going to be judgmental and be like those religions or anything. No born-again Christians or anything. And we're going the right way, asking questions. We're just never going to settle on anything. And that's the way to be a good person and be enlightened. And unfortunately, it's not up to you. What you think is irrelevant. What I think personally, is also irrelevant. You know, what I want is irrelevant. The Lord obviously has this. And I know for a fact that he works all things for good for those who love him and are called according to his purpose. I know that he works things for good. I know he also takes people off the planet, but I know he works things for good. And I know that he's the only source of love that there is in the entire consciousness of human. It's the only source of love. If you want to say it or whatever, fine. I'm just saying that's the only source of comfort, satisfaction, joy, peace with the world, peace with self, healing, and all that. It only flows from that access point, and or it doesn't flow. Not that there's any fixed locational point, of course not. But there are absolutes. One would be, you know, to love God. Find out who He is. Find out His ways. His ways are above our ways. His solutions are good. Ours are not. It's that simple. When you finally realize what it is by looking back over, I mean, I think this is going to be a big lesson where we have all this advanced technological society and it goes to the dystopian future we're all predicting now, consciously. Plus, we have to have the end times and tribulation and mass death. Everyone's programming that into humanity to have that. You realize that, do you not? That we're all being programmed to accept that, yes? And yes, these people saying the name of Jesus, coming along with fear porn, I understand. Prediction after prediction, false, yet more and more flock to them. What is that? Why is that? What possible good purpose could there be in that? Well, I did my song, False Prophet. Thank God I did that. There's nobody else that's got a song like that. So I need to put that back out there. You mean they lie? And they make money? You see what part the music has had in all this, don't you? Very, very, very vital. It doesn't matter if it's acknowledged by Billboard 100 or whatever. It's been absolutely spot on. We'll look back and we'll see that. You know, and that's the journey that remains after the Zeff Report is you know, going into, you know, we've kind of covered everything over the last 12 years, 12 and a half, going on 13 now. We've pretty much covered it all. Or is it going on 14? Where are we now? Is it 2012? Oh, I'm sorry. Oh my God, it's older than I thought. So 2002 to 2012 would be 10 years, right? 2013, 11. 2014, 12. 2015, 13. But it would be, let me try to add this up. Okay, so if you go to from 2002 to 2012, you have, oh shoot. Well, I guess, let's see, if you go from 2012 to 2002, that would be exactly 10 years on March 9th. Then you go to March 9th the next year, that'd be 11. I mean, 2013. Then you go to the next year, 2014, and that would be 12. So at the end of 2014, in March, it would be 12. So 2015 March would be 13. Trish, would be this be the 13th year or the 14th year? So it would be 13 years on March 9th, correct, of 2015? Well, we're going over 13 years. We're on our way to our we're in our 14th year then. Well, okay, I was a year off. I used to think I was 60, and then I found out I was 61. So I'm a year off. We're in our 14th year. I mean, hey, look at this. Isaiah preached and prophesied 44 years, right? 44 years. I was just thinking, you know, 14 years is nothing compared to that. So it's all relative, obviously. 44 years, that's quite a thing. You know, the people say they hacked him, they cut him in half. It was like, well, rumor has it, it's not completely proven, but rumor has it that he was hiding in a tree. Because, see, prophets of old, they would be, he prophesied to the king was it Hezekiah at that time? Well, anyway, he was prophesying, you know, to the leadership. And then just like Jeremiah, you know, then they'd be out of favor. And then they have to go hide, right? And then they send the king's men after him to cut him in half. And, you know, they did the same thing with Elijah. And then they want to hear what he has to say. So it's this back and forth thing with the prophets. But yeah, he was hiding in a tree and they cut the tree down. And in so doing, they cut him in half. That's the story. No, I wasn't inadvertent. I mean, I guess they knew they were cutting the tree down and him. But they had to get him, they had to cut the tree in half. So, well, I just came across, you know, some fresh, you know, writing about Isaiah just the other day. So that's why I'm kind of up on it. Well, because Isaiah, you know, prophesied for today's generation as well. Oh, I know, throw them all out, it's all relative. Yeah, okay, fine. Anyway, it's very, very much coming to a head. But 14, 7 and 7 may be my last year of this sort of thing, but it may not be. I mean, I hate to say, for example, when I pull off of this today, I have to do dialogue for something I'm producing. If you say that the podcast is, you know, well, Let's put it this way. I have people I know that they came to hear me through music. And then eventually they listen to a podcast. And people that prefer, you know, that understand I'm very innovative, experimental, and you never know what I'm going to do musically. So they're always waiting to see what's going to happen next. They already know everything I'm going to say here. Then there's other people who understand, you know, well, they don't know it changes, it's different, but it's, you know what I mean, it progresses as time goes on. But to them it's like they're not into religion or spirit talks or anything like that. Well, I think what I do is I'm kind of helping people to understand this world so that they can obviously make the right choice and fix their lives. I'm not interested, I'm just like Jesus, you know, same thing. I don't want to condemn people. I'm not here to condemn them. I mean, I might mock some of them who feel they're like, you know, they become their own gods. And you know, but you know, of course. But I'm not here to condemn anyone. I want them to, you know, get right with the Lord and realize that there's really no life without him, so they can just figure it out, fix it, and you know, in the process, fix the world. I don't want to see children crying and people, you know, children have to look at the adults doing these awful things to each other and go, "Mommy, Daddy, why are you doing that?" You know, I don't want to hear that. I don't want to see that. I don't want people to be in pain. I don't want to see pain. I don't want people to die without knowing why they lived. I don't want to see that. I don't want to see children wishing to commit suicide because their parents are so screwed up, because they abuse their kids. I don't want to see that either. I don't want to see parents selling their kids out into the satanic world to give them a chance to make something of themselves. I don't want to see that kind of thing. Selling their children out before their children have a chance to figure out what the world is. I don't want to see that sort of, I don't want to see them selling kids out in the churches. Rather, I'd rather see them baptized in the name of Jesus Christ and understand who God is. Not have God and then be, you know, sold out at the same time. That just means they're double-minded. And double-minded is an unstable person. They're only stable because the hive mind keeps them in a stable position. I don't want to see that either. And further to that, I don't want to see a whole landscape of zombies out there. Of people who've just given up. No, I do not. I mean, Lord, I must say we need more evidence of you here. But I think, you know, I'm evidence of the Lord's working. I'm plenty evidence. Especially for people that were back in my hometown of Los Angeles who pretty much all wrote me off as being, you know, the next one in the grave. You know, it's the Lord that made the difference there. And because he did, you should all be on your faces. If you're sneaking around listening to me, which some of you do from time to time, hopefully you hear this podcast and get right with God and stop wondering whether Zeph's telling the truth or not, or whether he's just deluded. Well, you know, I don't object that much to the Matrix-like world because I realize, here's what I realize. No man can get out of this situation on his own. It seems the only way we can get out is through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, because he has to save us from this situation. Once we're born again with him and we're getting out of here, you know, after we you know, escape from here is the kingdom of heaven, you know, the kingdom of God, really, which is everything but this particular terrarium we're in. So I have no problem with the terrarium thesis. In a sense, it's a spiritual terrarium. You know, we're locked, tethered, stuck, fallen here. And we need to escape this, right? It's what all the pyramids were built for, so they could have a nice journey, but they didn't realize that they weren't going to the absolute, they were going to the relative, so they could never make a journey out of this situation. So the pharaohs all had to be reborn. They didn't make it. None of them did. The Egyptian Book of the Dead, or the Tibetan Book of the Dead for that matter, both failed because both were relying on man's wits to get through it. And having favor with the gods, which is basically stuffing you back into the machine again, which is, you know, what we don't want, right? So that's why I think there's Jesus. I think the salvation, really, the picture of salvation, what it really is escaping this, that salvation. And man cannot do it on his own, I just guarantee it. You can all think you could do it on your own through meditation and whatnot, you never will. The Buddhists, I'm sorry, through self-works, through their own works and efforts, they can make it through. Any Zen master will tell you, well, it's based on a lie. Well, they know that. But that's part of your enlightenment or Satori process. You're supposed to figure that out. And then when you say no Zen and no master, they go, you made it. And then from that point, you have to find the Lord. Yes. Yes, it's folly. Sorry. It's a nice cultural thing. I like the tea and the, you know, the architecture and the martial arts and all that that came from Zen. It was all really cool. But it's all really, really relative. And some Buddhists wouldn't walk on a blade of grass. You know, they didn't want to make a bad cause for which there is always an effect. So the yoke becomes very heavy of everything, very heavy. But ultimately, all Buddhists fail. And Buddhists know that because the reason Buddhists, well, around, they can play, you know, Buddhist teacher and Buddhist meditation leader and they have a lot of them around here. In fact, someone I think I knew when I was a kid, she's here as some kind of Buddhist guru kind of woman. Well, I didn't know her that well, you know, but it's interesting. She was from Los Angeles, and she eventually came here and became some kind of like Buddhist leader, you know. And then you see the progressive left-wing politics involved in all Buddhism in Santa Fe. And pretty soon you see it's the LGBT thing all wrapped up in it too. And it's all about the rainbow flag. It all goes to that and forced vegetarian or veganism and they hate your effing guts. Let me explain this to you. If you have the truth, these people hate your guts. The most intolerant people in the world are the people that claim to be tolerant. I don't claim to be tolerant, okay? I am not tolerant, but they are. There used to be a sign when you come into Santa Fe, it goes, Santa Fe, an all-inclusive city. And what that means is you who fear the Lord, you would be excluded from that group. And it's so hypocritical. There's such a double, you'd think they would see themselves, but they don't. They really think they're right. They really think they're the hand of God. They think they're good people. They think they're enlightened. And then they go to the sushi bar. You know, they might have a vegan sushi though. They have their meetings. And then you know what the whole thing becomes? Like this Buddhist gal that's here with the big leader here. It all devolves into paganism eventually. It goes right back to paganism. The same syncretism of pagan, witchcraft, left-wing politics, you know, New Ageism, Lucifer, right? All, you know, with light paganism, not heavy, light paganism in under the Buddhist thing with the Tibetans now, the Rinpoches and the rest. Some of these white people are calling themselves Rinpoche now. Yeah, they're the Rinpoche, you know, which is this kind of honorary term of Buddhist priest or whatever, you know, from Tibet. The Rinpoche is the teacher, right, the leader. I guess it's like rabbi in a way. But I kid you not. And then it's all tied in with left-wing politics and the politics of tolerance and the promotion of alternative lifestyles. I'll just let it go at that. All that includes, which is total intolerance for anybody that, like, you could be quietly just pursuing your own thing, and then the minute they talk to you and find out that you're following, you know, the Lord or whatever, and what he says goes, and, you know, and you're a Bible believer or whatever, as soon as you bring that up, they will attack. They want to put you in jail. They want to basically kill you. And it's because they see you as being a block to what they really want, which is totalitarianism and mass death, their own. But they don't realize that. They don't realize it leads to that. The crime is the reason that it goes that way is because they are basically propping themselves up as dictators. And they have no absolute moral compass. So it's just whatever they feel is right, it's right. Whatever they feel is wrong, is wrong. Anyway, that's the way this town is run. I try to stay out of there. Most people in Santa Fe are really ignorant, and they all think they know something, which makes the ignorance even more palpable. And I prefer Albuquerque, where they don't put on airs like that, right? They're much more normal people in Albuquerque, meaning, you know, they don't, like a lot of people, they don't know, you know, they've been dumbed down about the Lord and about God. God's evil and Bible's evil, and they're being conditioned, yes, but they're much more accessible, much more reasonable. The people here are not reasonable at all. They're completely intolerant, and like I say, they're almost like totalitarian among themselves in their ethos, in their social ethos. There's a hard yoke here of conformity that is just, it's just insane. And if you don't fit that paradigm, I mean, they just basically either ignore you or they feel threatened. What you have to do to survive if you get in a confrontation is you have to really be confident in the Lord and just let the Lord speak through you. And then they usually run back to their Subarus and with their coexist stickers and their, you know, goddess stickers and everything, and they run and they screech out of the parking lot angry, and then they go home. I mean, I've seen this so many, I've been through this so many times that it's, And I would ask any of them, you know, I'd say, well, what do you expect me to do? You know, the Lord made me the way I am. I'm sorry. He made you the way you are. Okay. So how are we going to ever get along if you hate me, but you say that I hate you? See, all I have to do to be popular, ladies and gentlemen, is just give that part of myself up and just say, you know what? It's all, hey, it's anything, everything's everything, man. You know, it's like, I'm totally tolerant. I'm down with, you know, whatever, you know, but then there's a heavy, heavy yoke of ageism that comes in after that. So if you go real tolerant and everything and everything's cool, then the next step of devolution is basically, if you're old, you're invisible, you know. So there's this whole fight to do the facelifts and all the stuff to stay relevant in some way. Or at least be some kind of artiste or some kind of poet or writer that has kind of like the essence of the real Native American vibe or something. So it really goes with the Southwest experience of, you know, and then you know, there's all this competition for that kind of seat at the table. And, you know, because a common person can maybe rise to that level of literary approval by the intelligentsia, who have a hardcore iron yoke of totalitarianism and a police state already over Santa Fe, New Mexico, big time. Just like, it's the same thing in Sedona. You'll find the same thing. Santa Fe and Sedona have been ruined by the progressive movement, both of them. Which is the new ageism, which is the UFO thing, which is all that, which is the new age politics, if you will, which is the new world order, which is Madame Blavatsky, which is, you know, that path. And that path always leads to totalitarianism and mass death. I can't say it. What do you want me to do? Like, if I were to like it, I would say, yeah, let's have some totalitarianism and some mass death. I'm with you guys. Yeah, let's love one another. Yeah, but if you overturn all that, you're talking about overturning, you know, the hatred of gays and the, you know, the how we have to teach the kids tolerance in school, and, you know, otherwise it's just a hateful society. Well, does that include teaching white people that they ought to kill themselves? Because some progressives are teaching that very thing, along with the gay politics and the rest of it, yes. Don't worry, you're not being left out. The whole joke about the gay thing is that, you know, the gay people that I know, they would never put up with any of this or gay marriage or anything else. The whole point was they were rebelling, you know, they were promiscuous. They were running around. They had a whole thing going on, you know. They ran Hollywood. They ran the world in a way. They ran the fashion industry. They ran how many things? The arts. And they never seemed, they were running it 50 years ago. So, you know, and then the secret societies, they're all pretty much gay, right? And then they act like they're not, and then they go to church. You know, I don't know. Look, what can I say? You know, what was it, Kurt Cobain? What can I say? Everyone is gay. I mean, you know, it's all a big, just stupid thing we do. Such a stupid thing we do. Which then leads to pure hatred, to Rosie O'Donnell saying, anyone that likes Donald Trump, I'm going to save up my menstrual blood and rub it on their faces. And that was her big statement. Very intelligent woman, by the way. Yeah, you all ought to bow down to her. And so that was her big solution to the problem, that she's real tolerant, you know, she's very gay and tolerant, right? Yeah, oh yeah, very. Well, she says it's because there's a war on women. So she has to fight back against, oh, don't tell me, people have a different political view than her. You mean hypocrite? Oh, you mean we shouldn't listen to her as a society? No, if we have a rule about that, then we wouldn't listen to her. But we do. And when she says she's going to smear her period blood on you, Oh, boy, that's really serious. And I mean, I have to turn away from embarrassment of all humanity and say to the Lord, Lord, I mean, forgive us all for how someone like this ever exists. I don't know. And she has followers who believe she's fighting the good fight against that intolerance out there. It's madness, friends. It's madness, isn't it? It's all lies, isn't it? She's a liar. They're all liars, aren't they? Yes. Yes, they cheat. The Rinpoches cheat. The women gurus cheat. LGBT cheats. The racist thing is all cheating and all lying. The progressive movement cheats, but so does the establishment Republican movement. Cheats, rigs the game. It's maddening. All these people are liars. All their leaders are liars. Not one of them is reliable. We better have some laws that God has given us. Because, you see, if we rely on them, who happen to be our leaders, by the way, we're going to go to mass death. We're going to all die.
Oh, yes. That's the plan.
I know you love it when I scream like that. I think I may be just echoing what's already in your head and what you're trying to cope with, so just know that you're not alone. And believe me, I do, you know, the idea of going to Santa Fe and walking down Canyon Road and looking at all the wonderful anointed art would be a thing of, you know, something that I would try to avoid. And I have for many years avoided walking down that street simply because it's an act of self-torture. My daughter summed it up best. Right? I took her there. I drove her there on my motorcycle. I had an Indian motorcycle. And I took her there on the Indian. And we went up and down the road. And she goes, I could do that. That was her attitude. She'd go to every gallery. This is, Francesca, check this out. It's 15 grand, you know. Oh, gosh, I could do that. Really? 15 for that? You got to be kidding me. I mean, that's up and down the entire street. It was like that. Because they lie. The arts have been controlled to make them devolve from the great art of the Renaissance so that, you know, I mean, it's okay if you're, I like doing collage art that's abstract. I love good abstracts, you know, but not to take the place of you know, of representative art that shows a great deal of skill and there is a lot of art around here that's like desert landscapes and things, you know what I mean? I mean, I don't mean to, you know, crash it all. I'm sure there's good, worthy art on Canyon Road. It's just also fraught with politics and everything that I know there's some of you now taking issue with me and saying, all I'm saying is this. If you want to put abstract art as a way of getting rid of the structure of the past or laws of the past, do you know what I'm saying? You don't understand. It's part of the overturning of Western civilization. You have to agree with some of the masters, the Dutch masters, and the various people that, you know, Michelangelo and things. You have to admit that was, you know, there's some amazing anointed skill involved, yes? Would you prefer just abstract, just throwing paint at... When I was a kid, there were people making a fortune. Just they would take paint, they'd rent a warehouse space, and they literally just throw paint at the canvas, globs of it. And they go out and sell it for, you know, a ton of money. They're making a living doing things like that. Well, perhaps that's not the best subject to bring in here, but I mean, that's what you have with Santa Fe, New Mexico. You have this great intolerance that when you see the word inclusive, that means totally intolerant and even like a authoritarian regime has taken hold. And they use the various social issues as prongs of the Communist Manifesto. i.e. to destroy the world. Why destroy the world? Through enslavement of mankind and totalitarianism, I'd say if they got their way globally, their so-called New World Order, it would be a destruction of the world while they play in their, when they're, you know, the billionaire and trillionaire class would be playing in the fields of Elysium, enjoying themselves while the rest of the world suffers in cages. That's where it leads. Hey, look, it's not a deduction. It's just an absolute fact. And you know, I didn't make it up. I didn't deduce it. I'm just stating the, you know, sun rises in the east, sets in the west. Please don't blame me. I'm just the messenger. I'm just telling you, you keep down this path, that's what you get. You know, we all need to turn back to God, including all these groups who are basically just a thin-veiled rebellion toward God or rebellion toward Western civilization, which they disagree with the founding of it because they want to go back to the ancient paganism of do what thou wilt, etc. It goes back to the Garden of Eden, folks. It goes back to the very beginning. It goes back to the very origin. And unfortunately, it's just, you know, the wheat and the tares are growing together and there'll be this fight. There never will be peace. Jesus does not bring peace. He brings a sword. He brings division between people. If you hear division here, oh, we're not singing Kumbaya. Zeph, if you just became a new ager, we'd all get along just great. If you just get rid of the Bible and just start going with, we all have God, we're all children of God here on the earth, and we all going to sing and dance and play together and, you know, and have no borders and have no boundaries for our kids. Let them develop the way they want to develop, you know, and let their, you know, let, I mean, if boys want to play with, you know, dolls and girls want to play with tanks, and it's all cool, man. I mean, can't you just lay off it? Let it just go the way it wants to go. Versus having a bunch of rules where everybody breaks the rules secretly anyway. It's all hypocrisy. So you might as well just let people just be natural, just like, you know, James Cameron attached to the tree of, you know, the mother tree. And, you know, everybody's just kind of like, you know, does what they feel, you know, and without feeling like there's intolerance, feeling accepted, whatever way they want to, you know, if 2 and 2 is 6, and that's fine. And if whoever wants to touch each other, just go ahead and touch each other the way you want, and everyone do what they want, and just do what you want. You know, what's wrong with a world like that? You know, income equality, you know, everybody's going to have the same dole, and, you know, they'll be able to have Soma as, you know, government-sponsored drugs and all the sex they want and just, you know, and all the things they want to do, and just, they just have to not see that it's a horrible world. They just, because if you see that it's a horrible world, you're not going to feel really free. So we just need to get rid of all the bad people that make it a horrible world so that the children can play. What's wrong with the children playing? Mama, let your children play. And the answer to that is that's an ancient ruse. Basically, that's the serpent in the garden. Did God say, let your children play, blah, 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 blah. And when we have no discipline and children just do what they want and they end up eventually dictating to the adults, it becomes Lord of the Flies and it becomes another insane murder fest. That's why we have rules. That's why God has laws, to prevent that sort of thing. Okay? Anything else I left out here, Trish? Okay. Well, you know, I just figured since these people on YouTube keep saying the same thing over and over again, you know what I mean? They get nowhere. I figured, well, you can have, I've said this in other ways before, but I don't think it was so honed as today's, do you? Today was, as I get older, you see, I get the, I'm getting the gifts, the benefit of that old, you know, I would hope that one day, I mean, my favorite of all of them, when he would speak. He had such command, and he's still around. Is John Hurt. You know John Hurt? And maybe, you know, as I get older, I could become more like John Hurt and really, you know, I love hearing, like I see an old man with a beard telling a story and, you know, and having diction and elocution, you know, and then having it be tempered with age. And then it's just like, it doesn't even matter what the guy says. You just want to listen to it, right? Maybe I could become someone like that or retire. The reason, if there's any repeat on this, and there will always be on God, is because it needs to be repeated. Because it's the what do preachers do? You know, I mean, it's the same thing. What do teachers do? Right? The same principles are going to keep being taught here, again and again, through various ways. What I do is I mix up all the ways we come at it. Truth is always going to be truth. The relative. Well, I shouldn't. I mean, you know. People want to come to Santa Fe and fall down in front of a guru, or I'm sorry, a Buddhist Rinpoche, and be anointed by the Tibetan, by the Dalai Lama himself, and then lead the people in their meditations and their progressive politics and their vegan bake sales and whatnot. They're fine. Fine. It's just I feel that I would only be a cause of trouble if I were to show up at your feast. And so to do you a great favor, I think I'll avoid that. But you don't offend me, really. I know what you're going to do and what you're going to talk about. But I offend you. And never the twain shall meet, you see. There will never be a time that I don't offend you. And there will never be a time where you don't offend reality. You know, I would love to tell you New Agers this one thing, which is what you Buddhists are, New Agers. I would like to tell you one thing. You're not fooling anybody. And reality is what it is. It's not what you wish it would be. Or not because you like to think about different possibilities. Then all these become potential realities. That's just a cop out for not going to the truth. The truth is the only thing that will set you free, not your meditation. Although meditation could be very good for you. I think meditating is a nice thing to do. I try to do that every night. A lot of times when I'm not sleeping, I'm meditating. And I try to free my mind of all the, you know, thoughts that I'm hanging on to and grabbing onto, and I'm trying to really, you know, just let things just be, you know, and just really, you know, eventually you can perceive that, you know, there's a perceiver that's not you, and you know, it's not about you, and you know, you get kind of right with things, but you know, I always have to have, you know, whenever I breathe, it's like Yahweh, you know what I mean? So I'm always conscious of that. Yahweh, breath, you know, that Yahweh, you know, that. Always conscious of that. And that's always going back to the source of everything. And no, it's not Saturn, sorry, it's not a cube. Excusez-moi. No, you could call it Molech if you like, or do whatever you like. You could just make it all up as you go along if you like. That's what all the Satanists have done. They've done that very thing, and they worship Saturn, and they, you know, they want totalitarianism, and they want blood, guts, and three world wars, and a new world order, and all that stuff, you know. And then these people in Santa Fe, the New Agers, are railing against that. They're thinking with the revolution in consciousness, we can have an Armageddon bypass. That the Armageddon is all a result of the Judeo-Christian consciousness, which must be overturned at all costs. And, of course, that they don't admit that, but that's exactly what they think. And because of that, we have a problem. They want reality to be what they say it is, not what it is. Right? They are the authoritarians of our society, and they all go together as birds of a feather. Oh, you'd see them down at, You know, they'd be down at the Theosophical Research Society or the Philosophical Research Society or the Theosophical Society. You know, they're all throughout L.A. They'd be at the Vedanta Society. I've been to all of them. They'd be at the Zen Center. There's two of them. They'd be at the Krishna Center. I've been to all those. I've been to every one of them. I've been to all of them. The City Yoga Center, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And it's all the same thing. They would listen to Marianne Williamson, who tries to make a go at politics and so far has failed. But, you know, Marianne Williamson talks about spiritual issues, she says, but it's all about left-wing politics. It's got nothing to do with spiritual issues. That's the veneer. But the truth is, it's all about politics with her, which I'm glad to see she's come out of the closet now, at least going for politics rather than this gobbledygook Course in Miracles. Well, she started teaching the Course in Miracles. But then it kind of went into more New Agey kind of thing, you know. She's kind of dropped that because there's too much, I think, even in Course in Miracles. Isn't Course in Miracles, there's a lot of Jesus in that? I think so. It's almost like Science of Mind, you know. I mean, if it isn't, then, you know, I stand corrected. But I've been through that. You know, people have sent me the Course in Miracles books, and it's, you know, it's just more channeled stuff. It's all right. Science of Mind, the same thing. They try to make an ecumenical thing, so Jesus is in there. Scripture quotes, Buddhist sutra quotes, Hindu quotes, Upanishads quotes, Mahabharata quotes, Quran quotes. You know, right? And various people, and they try to balance it out and say, look, pursue all these great ideas. There's all these great Lao Tzu quotes, you know, Confucius, et cetera, et cetera. And they have all these quotes for all the wisdom. And so you follow the Science of Mind, and through that you get healed. And then there's, you know, and then there's Christian Science. And there's many other derivations, but I'm not particular about it because I think anyone's quest for truth leads to truth. So if you have a quest for truth, it leads to truth. If you quest for God, you'll get God. You know, if I quest for God and I have the Science of Mind there, I will eventually cut through that and drop the book down and go to God. You know what I mean? And if so, for whatever method. Look, I need God because I need to have answers, and I need to have comfort, and I need to have love. You know, I mean, and I need to be nurtured, and I need to be directed, and I want my life to be directed, but I want God to put me where He wants me. And like today, we had to have a kind of a tough talk day because if we don't do something about the direction we're going, we will all die, and it won't be very pleasant, and our children will die. So what we want is we don't want that result. You know, these people that, you know, you might have called progressive, whatever, they're not really any of those labels. They're at war with humanity, and they've gotten, you know, into positions of power. And they use chemicals, and they use, they have plans and eugenics and everything else to eradicate, you know, most of the population of the earth. And they're at war with morals, they're at war with God, they're at war with quality of life. And yet they pose as the saviors, as the leaders, as the head of the medical board or the EPA or this or that. And there they are. But I mean, behind the scenes, that's not what they do. It's all about this war with God and war with humanity. And that's all it is. It's not a 50 questions, excuse me, those people that want to be all relative out there. Oh, well, here's a bunch of questions regarding. No, no, no. It's basically this. It's a war against God by Satanists. Who may or may not know they're Satanists, but that's the side they're fighting on, period. Now, there isn't anything more to it than that. I wish that we would just simply tell the truth and be simple about it so that the children would understand and be able to choose the right way to go. I got more hope in the kids now than I do in the adults are terrible. My generation, terrible. You all are terrible. I'm hoping the next generation, or maybe the one after the millennials, will be, you know, will want the truth. You know, I'm just hoping they rebel against their parents and rebel against the schools. and say no more of this crap. And they want the truth and they want to live right. You know, Moses had a big problem with naysayers and grumblers, backbiters, and murmurers. And eventually they rebelled and they started, you know, having orgies. Of course, the orgy and the golden calf go together. The New Ageism, Luciferianism, orgies, the gold children, all goes together. Baphomet, two kids, it goes together. Over and over and over, the same thing repeated. It's not like you have to be a genius to figure this out. Everywhere you go, it's repeated over and over the same thing. The politics, the authoritarianism, the intolerance, the mores, the sexual proclivities, the children, the rituals, the symbols, I mean, why not just lay it out and go, hey, we worship Lucifer, and this is what it's about, rebellion toward God on all fronts. So we want laws that establish our way this time, not God. So we want to be completely intolerant of anything other than our way, and very tolerant of all of our fun, you know, do what thou wilt. And anything that stands in the way needs to be gotten rid of so we can finally proclaim victory, set up our Baphomet statues, put our rainbow flags on the rainbow thing. I'm not seeing it as a gay thing. I see that as a political thing. Understand that. Everyone's so afraid of being judged. I'm not judging anyone here. You know, whether you fall into this kind of thing or that kind of thing, whatever you're doing, you know, there is a lesson about sex. And it's like this, if it becomes like it was when I was in high school, just denigrated to where anything is anything and nothing is nothing, and it's just like going to the bathroom, or it doesn't even matter, if, you know, whatever. It's just, it becomes degraded to that point. The person gets degraded to that point. That's all. It's, people don't try to understand the gift of sex. They don't try to understand what it's all about. They just, you know, they just go with the lowest common denominator. You know, no thinking, whatever they feel like. Whatever they feel is true. If anyone doesn't agree with that, then there's something wrong with them. We need laws to legislate against them. If for spiritual reasons or God-fearing reasons, they don't want to acknowledge a gay wedding, the thing you do is you fine them. You fine them something they can't pay. You vilify them, you destroy their business, and destroy their lives. And that's just the way we roll now. Complete, total, 100% intolerance. That's the way it rolls. 100% authoritarianism, fascism. And that's what that flag represents now. Fascism. Intolerance. Totalitarianism. Authoritarianism. No free thought. Enslavement. It doesn't represent freedom. It doesn't represent liberating people from all the awful things of the past. It represents enslavement, mind control, totalitarianism, etc. Along with the, you know, throw in all the other prong issues. Why they became politicized like that? Because the whole goal isn't about that. Nobody gives a damn about that. It's about the end game. And all these are like little tributaries that feed into the end game. Everything is politicized now. So we can finally do what we have to do. Control from cradle to grave and population and eugenics, everything and everyone. That's the Nazi final solution of Adolf Hitler. Now look. If you don't want to go that way, if you want a future for your children, you've got to find your common sense again and just say, you know, right is right, wrong is wrong. I mean, it's just really simple. It's not right is whatever I say it is. Whatever we as a group decide it is, that's what it is. Okay, you know what I'm going to say. I'm going to stop now. Yay, I'm going to stop now. Yay. Here goes the bad guy. Goodbye.